Good morning, everybody. This is a new seminar from the Instituto de Astrofisica de Andalucía. And today we will have the talk by Dr. Almudena Prieto from the Instituto de Astrofisica de Canarias. And she will talk about the power of low activity black holes. Dr. Almudena Prieto, she did the PhD at the ESA International Ultraviolet Explorer Observatory. And then she moved as a postdoc to the Space Telescope European Coordinating Facility in Garching in Germany, and later to the Max Planck Institute for Extraterrestrial Physics in Munich. From 1994 to 1996, she was the instrument scientist at the Rosat X-ray Observatory, where she got responsible for the end-of-life calibration of the Rosat PSPC camera. From 1998 to 2003, she was ESO responsible for the first definition and implementation of services mode operation at the BLT. From 2003 to 2006, she was the coordinator of the Active Galactic Nuclei studies with adaptive optics instrument at the Max Planck Institute for Astronomy in Heidelberg, also in Germany. Since 2004, she is principal investigator of the PARSEC project and the Spanish principal investigator of the instrument FRIDA, the first adaptive optic facility for a Grand Deccan telescope. Since 2006, she's senior astronomer at the IAC, and since this year, she's associate scientist at the Computational Astrophysics Group of the Munich University Observatory. So, Almudena, now the floor is yours, and we will wait for your talk.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Rene. Thank you very much. Good morning to everybody. I hope you hear me. You hear me well, René?
Yeah, perfect, yes.
Okay. I'm going to talk about low activity black holes, or most commonly known perhaps as low luminosity agents. And let me first introduce where is the context of this work, where it arises, and he arises in the... Oh, I cannot pass the transparencies. Why? Sorry, I cannot pass. Ah, yeah. Yes. This work of low luminosity black hole, or low luminosity AGNs, or low activity black holes, arise in the context of the project PARSEC. So I just wanted to introduce what is this project. PARSEC is a multivalent investigation of the central, the nucleus of the relatively nearby galaxies at PARSEC scales, and we do it across the entire electromagnetic spectrum. We focus on nuclei of, in general, very well-known galaxies because are nearby. We get up to Virgo, and we are trying to get a little bit farther, but the scales, physical scales that we want to sample, PARSECs limit us a little bit to get not very far from our close universe. And with this, we are running this space since many years, and there are quite a number of people working on it. We study the nuclei, but also the activity of these nuclei, but also the environment of the nuclei. We see star formation, and we can study as well the interstellar medium around the center of galaxies, and all with very extremely high angular resolution, because we have many facilities, fortunately nowadays, to be able to compare equivalent physical scales, which is just the point of PARSEC, same equivalent physical scales all the way from the centimeter wavelength up to the UV and eventually up to the high energies. So, low activity black holes is one of the topics we are studying for the last years. And what I wanted to say, what I'm going to say is a lot has been done with one of my closest collaborators, which is Juan Antonio Fernandez Ontiveros in Rome. So low luminosity agents or low activity black holes are objects that by definition have very low Eddington ratios. I would say that this is the best definition from them and are not the classical active nuclei with emitting a 10% Eddington, quasars or even higher, but we have with Eddington luminosities below 10 to minus 3 to very extreme low values. And that's because they emit very low, the luminosity is very low, and usually their black holes at the center are very massive. But they have other characteristics that are making them even more interesting, is that very often when the spectral distributions do not have a key feature for an active nucleus, even if it's a low activity, which is the blue bump. And the blue bump is the best signature, is our clear signature of the presence of an accretion disk. And these objects do not show it. And we know from the scales we have now that also they don't have an infrared bump, which would be the dust emitting, which is reprocessed by the energy, the photons in the accretion disk. So these objects also do not show it. And nevertheless, this type of objects, low luminosity, are very common. It's the most common activity of phase of a black hole. Probably what it represents is the longest phase or the duty cycle of a nucleus. It's time in active form, and most of the time they are in this type of almost very low activity or dormant phase, like the center of our galaxy. So obviously people ask, why is that? Why we come to this phase? What reasons make this phase appear? Why do we see the signature or the accretion disk? So there are various questions that they might explain what is the case. One obvious is that these objects do not have material to accrete. Many of them reside in ellipticals in early type galaxies, so it's quite reasonable to pose this possibility. And the idea that is more solid within the community and is getting much more momentum in many years is that indeed these objects become really very inefficient relatively, very, very inefficient. So that is why they are so low luminous. Now the point is, why is that the case? So I want to address the case of the insufficient fuel, because there is a lot of them, a lot of material to accrete, but I want to make it clear or discard that possibility by showing you dust maps that we do with very high physical scales of the central 500 parsecs of these galaxies, of active galaxies, and also of low luminosity agents. So I'm going to compare very briefly only the dust map, the structure of the map that we can resolve in filaments and lanes with just next to the nucleus of these galaxies. I'm going to compare dust maps of a low luminosity agent, for example, in this slide you have at the top a low luminosity agent is 10 to the 42 volumetric luminosity, very low Eddington ratio 10 to minus 4, and compare the same scales with a classical active nucleus, like 1068, everybody know about this object, which is two order of magnitude higher in luminosity and three orders of magnitude higher in Eddington luminosity. Okay, so we can make dust maps of the central few hundred parsecs of these galaxies. That is what I shown here in this slide on the right side. And these are dust maps that I scale in optical depth. So the optical depth, when it's higher, becomes darker in the image. The nucleus of the galaxy is at the center of the image for both of them. You see that we look at 1068, we see a lot of structure. These are both are type 2. Nuclei, in the sense that in none of them we see the nucleus, it's obscured by dust. Okay, so in both have, as you see, plenty of structure, filaments and lasers intensity 8, we get optical depths up to 8 magnitudes, which is more than enough to obscure this 10 to the 44 nucleus. And if we go to the low luminosity AEN, we see even more structure in this particular case, just because it happened like that. The dust in filaments, very well defined, and spiraling and circularizing towards the central region where the optical depth progressively gets higher. And in this case, we measure optical depths that are a little bit lower, three magnitudes towards the center, but this is more than enough to hide a nucleus that is only 10 to 42. So there is plenty of dust in type 2 and, of course, as well in type 1. And I just wanted to do exactly the same exercise, but with two nuclei, one, like you have very active one, like you have in this galaxy at the, above, and a very low active black hole, like it's sombrero. These are type 1 objects. We see the nucleus up to the UV in both. Okay. And but here now the difference in Eddington luminosity between both is almost 5 orders of magnitude. It's enormous. In this, the luminosity also is 2 orders of magnitude difference. And we look at the dust in the central 100 passes of these galaxies, and we see in the very powerful one, AGN here is a Cipher 1 galaxy. You might even pay attention a bit to the filaments of dust here as well, like in the former case, also circularizing and spiral towards the center, but also in sombrero too. Sombrero is probably have the dust in a kind of way. An H1 galaxy, so we see all this structure of dust in the main plane of the galaxy. We see the nucleus very well. The optical depth of these filaments in this case is very low. These are type 1 sources, so we have no more than 1 magnitude in sombrero, so it's not much to this nucleus, because it's very mild, the dust, and it's not strong, it's not higher also around the center. And in this very powerful nuclei, we also have optical depths in comparison with the former case, were very high. Here is very low, but as type 1 is only 1.5 magnitude, but this is nothing for a nucleus that is 10 to the 44 per second, so it does not do anything to it. Well, these are 5 orders of magnitude difference in Eddington luminosity, but now we go to really the quiescent ones, and it's our the most dormant, obviously. We go to Andromeda, which you have here at the upper figure, or with 10 to minus 10 Eddington luminosity, or our Milky Way. Milky Way is even more awake, a little bit more awake than Andromeda. You see that the environment in the stellar medium is very similar. We have, again, these are dust maps, in this case, are in emission. This is infrared emission, the medium far infrared. So, because these are very nearby galaxies, and even with the satellites, we can resolve the dust. And you see, again, filaments, spiral to the center in Andromeda, well, in our Milky Way, in around Sagittarius, it is quite complex structure of dust around. So, all in all, there is a lot of dust, there is a lot of material ready to be accreted. Another thing is why it's not accreted, or if it's accreted, what happened with it? There is plenty, and it's very similar to what we have in the interstellar medium in our own galaxy. There's nothing special about it. So that's what I wanted to say about dust. I wanted to go now to the case where most people are focusing attention, believing that this is the reason why these objects are so low luminous is that the efficiency of the radiation. And I wanted to discuss first what is how we accrete usually in AGNs, what is our mechanism, the best physical mechanism we understand accretion occurs from binaries to AGNs, and is what we call the cold accretion, an accretion, this material accumulating, the accretion this becomes to lose angular momentum by process viscosity, other processes, and eventually might get embedded in the hole. So that is our best understanding of how we are feeding a black hole, and eventually might become active or not. So co-accretion is usually, we use the Sakura Sunyaev accretion disk, but accretion disk in general. So in general, for active galaxies in binaries as well, we see the signatures of this accretion disk, and this is a blue bump. So I want to show here the SDs of classical best SDs we can do now, a parser scales of type 1, cipher galaxy, cipher 1, cipher 2, and radio loud quasars. And a parsec scales covering the whole electromagnetic spectrum. This is an SED that goes from the radio centimeters wavelengths on the left all the way to the high energies. These are data, are not models. These are extracted for our best sampling SEDs we could get for prototype cipher 2 galaxies or cipher 1 galaxies. And that's, the radio loud quasars are the work has been done by Martin Elvis time ago. So by averaging these SEDs, so the best objects that we could sample at this parsec scale, we get, for example, the red line that will correspond to a prototype cipher type 2, showing the typical infrared bump. Okay, and then when you go towards the optical and UV, the spectrum falls down dramatically because type 2 nuclei means that we don't see the nucleus, it's absorbed, it's obscured, so it disappears. And then the high energies on the right, and then there's a big area, a big region here is the unabsorbable region, we cannot access it. Then we have the spectral distribution for a Taiwan galaxy, that again, in the same build, in the same form, same physical scales. Again, it shows major features, this infrared bump. Okay, but as we go in this bump from the infrared 10 microns down towards the optical, the spectrum does not fall. It recovers, it rises up, and even hints a kind of peak here that will be this our incipient signature of an accretion disk. And we see that the spectrum does not fall like in the type 2 because the nucleus of this galaxy is all are all visible at the UV, so the stream Lewis wavelength we can follow these objects. Okay, and if we go to the most powerful objects in the sky, which are the quasars, and specifically the radio loud quasars. This is the car by Martin Elvis, and then it shows also the same type of signature, the bump here, less pronounced because these are radio loud, so they get the radio emission dominates, but we still have a kind of bump in the towards the infrared, and the spectrum even falls down less because the attenuation by dust increases even less, very little, and it rises up immediately in the optical towards the UV. This is the signature of the accretion disk, which in radio loud, because are very bright, we can even go a high energies in the X-rays to see a bit rising up towards the UV. This is extreme X-rays. Okay, so that is the what we usually see for active nuclei. And when I compare with same physical scale and a CD or a low luminosity, the energy change dramatically. And I will put only here MET7 because MET7 is a classical, it's a prototype low luminosity agents. It's 10 to minus 5 Eddington luminosity, 10 to 42. For 42 as per second volumetric luminosity, this is very, very low luminous object. So these are the black points here, and of course it's very radio loud, so it emits a lot in infrared, has a strong jet, as you all know, it goes the spectrum from the radio all the way to the UV, it's almost a straight line, it crosses the infrared and goes down in the UV, but this object we see at the UV, at the stream, UV wavelength, we can detect it, we can observe now with the space telescope, we can see it. So it is not that it falls down because an extinction curve here, there is in addition no dust in MET7, but it does not rise up as you would expect for the signature of an accretion disk in this source. So this is very featured spectrum, let's say it's the stream K cases where we see low luminosity agents. And this is very common. It's not, and it's not specific for M87. We see this more and more in low luminosity agents. And it's known. You don't need much angular resolutions to see that. It's very well known since long. What we know now for angular resolutions, these high angular resolutions, the infrared bump is not present either. So I wanted to compare here M87 with another, that will be my two objects I will refer all the time in my talk, with another low luminosity AEM, which is Sombrero on the right side, you recognize immediately. And in this case, in Sombrero, within we see a bit of hint of an accretion disk, not the classical accretion disk, a bit cooler accretion disk. So that will be a representation of low luminosity AEMs, but in this case, maybe we are seeing the equations. In M87, is completely elusive without. So again, you have a spectral distribution from these nuclei. And this, as I said before, from radio on the left to high energy on the right. And here I put with these points are the cities when you get, when you don't go to this fine scale we are working on, you go to the usual our second scale, and you combine data from different instrumentations and different angular scales. So you get this kind of spectrum. It's much less featured, there's a rising up here, and the spectrum in Sombrero, there is quite a number of bumps here. This is what you do with normal angular resolutions, but the impact of putting angular resolution, getting to Parsec scale, is notorious, because this is the CD of the same core, but now we are to Parsec scales, and the change, the spectrum change. Okay. Parsec scales and being trying to be the more careful and consistent across the entire electromagnetic spectrum, just to sample the core. So again, this is the same spectrum I showed you before, the yellow line, a spectrum I showed you before for M87. The yellow line is the radiolab quasar from Martin, just to illustrate where the blue bump is, where it's not present. In M87, where the infrared bump is, and we are not seeing that clear in M87. And in Sombrero, again, the spectral distribution turns down as well. There is a kind of plateau here. That is why we think it might be an incipient of the presence of an accretion disk, but it's not the blue accretion disk at the position where it should be, which is this, the hot, the usual blue. Is if it is, it's much cooler. And the spectrum goes down up to the UV and we see it. It's not, you know, extinction here. So here is more I will refer always to these two extremes, M87 and Sombrero, as a characteristic representation, but I wanted to show you other cases that see a bit what we have, objects that are less well sample, it's very difficult, it's quite time consuming to produce this SCD, so not all the objects have as good sampling as could have M87, but I want to show you, for example, another one that is well sampled, like for example 1052, is well known, or 1097 on the top. Again, the white points here are the Parsec scale angular resolutions. The gray points at the background are low resolution data. You can compare the difference, and you see that the spectrum falls, for example, 1052 falls as almost a straight line all the way, for example, here from the infrared all the way down to the UV. Okay, and this the way of behaving we see as well in 1087 in all of them. This way of almost a quiet a straight line from infrared to the UV, prone to my colleague Juan Antonio Fernandez Tiberos to think that, well, these objects, these cities look very much like a jet emission. And so, pure jet emission. So, what he did in this slide I saw you are the same stamps as before, same objects, and now you see with very little points a simple synchrotron spectrum put on top. It's not really trying to fit it, but put on top of the data. Synchrotron spectrum is a combination of power law with a brave from optically thin to optically thin, a jet emission. And you might see that basically in all cases, they give a very reasonable representation of the CD, the data we have in general. So for this analysis, we went further and tried to fit these objects with a real jet emission. It's not simply trying to fit a power law, which indeed is a synchronous spectrum, is that, but take into account the condensation component and to include as well force in our modeling of the STDs to force the inclusion of a disk, because we need accretion. It's our best way to understand how black holes are fit. So we force the presence of an accretion disk, even though that in many cases the data do not indicate it. But we want to see at least the limits of this presence of accretion disk, not per limit. So here again, I come back to the two comparison objects, M87 on the left, Sombrero on the right. The black points are the cities I showed you before, 27 and for Sombrero. And here we use a more physical model. We put a jet with a pre-shock component for accelerated electrons, the post-shock, which is the cooling of the electron, the synchrotron emission is really what dominates the whole spectrum. We cannot constrain much the push-up, but it's not much relevant in a way at this moment because it's the cooling what really constrain all the modeling, all the fit. And the contornization component that we see with this orange line in the high energies, this contornization component, in fact, is not a component we can play with. Once we fit the cooling, the synchrotron component, the contornization is basically automatically fixed. We don't have much room to play with it. So the model is relatively well constrained, even though there are many parameters that we cannot constrain. But as a fit, the simple synchrotron cooling of the electrons and the contornization of the electrons, we can account for the whole SCD from radio up to the high energies with pure jet emission in the case of M87. We force the disk is here, but it's not required for the data, and so just get an upper limit you want for the disk. In Sombrero, it's different because Sombrero, as I said, we have a feature, we have a little bump here, and that the bump is used in the modeling, in the fitting to include a Sakura Sunyaev disk. So we can insert this. It's mostly dominated by jet emission. Most of the data, which is the black line here, is the jet emission, the cooling, synchrotron, and the contornization. But this bump, we could push it with an accretion disk, which is not the blue, typical blue bump hot accretion disk we see in stars and binaries, we see in active black holes. It's a cooler, it's a much cooler accretion disk moves towards the red. It's our only way, because in the UV we cannot put it. There is no emission there produced above. Okay. So having shown to you, try to demonstrate you that while we can account in as the simplest form with jet emission as an explanation, dominant emission of the core of these galaxies, the question is also is whether we see a jet in these objects. And of course, in M87, we all know about, but in other galaxies, it's less obvious. And again, you have to go back to high angular resolution to see any kind of collimated emission at the center. So we have been doing for a few objects, and we always see in other people, we are not the only ones, there is a lot of work done in the light to try to find, to try to detect yet in these objects. And you had to really go in angular resolution to see collimated. And I wanted to show you for the same objects I showed you before with the STDs. where how the radio millisecond scales, we can see kind of standard collimated emission in basically all cases. These are very small jets, what my colleague Mark Methuen called mini jets, are incipient structures. We can, so far at this moment, we can trace them to the in the very core region, but in all cases so far, we see the radio core, we see the core, of course, and kind of elongated emissions. So there is an incipient jet emission in all cases so far we have explored. Okay, so jet again seems to be present. We see them. It gives a good representation of the spectrum distributions. What has been done so far in trying to explain this object, because this is something that we are posing or presenting as yet is what dominates the mission. This is not what has been tried to be pushed in the past. So it had been a lot of work in the literature trying to account for the lack of a blue bump, the lack of an accretion disk in these objects, and how these objects accrete. And one of the theories that have been worked a lot is the idea of hot accretion, which is a very elegant form. Also, it could explain why these objects are so inefficiently radiated via this enormous amount of models that are called ADAF or RIAF or ADIOS. Is what is proposed also for our Sagittarius A, for our the center of our Milky Way. These are models in which it is assumed that, of course, because we do not see the accretion disk in the center, the central part of the accretion disk is has disappeared, it's truncated, it's gone, and we replace this hole for an unbounded flow. The idea is that these hot accretion are very hot electrons, and they do not couple well with protons, and so the protons cannot be pushed out. So most of them are unbounded in the hole. So most of what is accreted in this object, it can accrete a lot, but what happens is that most is unbounded in the flow in the hole, and so that is why they are low luminous sources. So these ADAF, RIAF, ADIOS models have a very particular spectral distribution shape. And now we can compare these SCDs with the parsec scale SCDs we are getting now from this object. So I want to show you here, for example, the case of M87. This is the work for Tiziana Di Matteo. These are the models they propose for M87, the black line, and on top are the red points are the spectral distribution we get a parsec scale. So you might see that the agreement is not very good. I don't think we are in this line to be able to explain this. So maybe we have a flow, but still we prefer the JET model because it accounts nicely for all the CD in a simple form. M87 is not the only case. People continue working for other ones. This is the case of 1052. The red line, again, the points are our parsec scales, SCDs. The black line is an ADAF model, in this case by you and collaborators. Okay, so the agreement is not very excellent. And again, here is another case, 1097. This is the black points, and the line is our JET model. How you see there how a JET model, a disk, fit, how we do it, how it is simply power law spectrum, the real JET model put here, including the continuation. And this is a real model by Gustav Nemen in red. Okay, so we think that pushing for the hot accretion, although it's a very elegant scenario, and it's a way naturally to explain this inefficiency of radiation of these objects. When you go to the data, so far the things do not fit well when you go down to these physical scales. So if we assume that we have a cold accretion, Sakura Sunyaev accretion disk, in some cases we do not see it, but suppose that we do not see it because it's less dominant, it goes towards the red, it gets cooler. So suppose that we are in this possibility and we need accretion anyway. We have another problem, which is that we do not have, with the accretion power we can estimate from the SCDs, enough power to explain the energy that these objects release. And this is a more crucial problem because we don't know where the power comes from. So I wanted to illustrate again with the two objects I was using all the time in the talk, M87, and I will show you after Sombrero what happened. So again, the same SCD as before, the fitting of the model, the red line, the points, and because we are at this basic angular scales, we can have directly, not from the model, directly from the data, we can put an upper limit on the accretion disk. Supposing that we obviously, the accretion disk we are fitting in this case is obvious that we do not constrain it, could be anywhere. You might see the disk is this blue point, it fits nothing, so we cannot constrain it, but we can go to the data directly and say, well, an accretion disk should be here. If it will be here, how much is its luminosity? We can have an upper limit on the accretion rate and the accretion power. And so if we do this exercise, of course, we get an upper limit and we get from this SCD's power, which is about 10 to 42. And we can compare now this power with the energy these objects are released. This power has been transferred and give account for the power is generating this source that we measure. So we can obviously measure the radiative luminosity. This is the easiest thing that we can do in astronomy always. We can, radiation is relatively easy to measure. We can integrate the whole SCD and say this is our radiative luminosity. As we assume it is mostly jet emission, we can deboost it as well. And okay, if we do all that, we get energy from this core, which is the order of a few 10 to the 41. So in principle, we might be okay with this upper limit of the accretion power. We can account for it. Now, the problem is that this object is not the radiated channel, the main channel of release energy. In low luminosity and in low active black holes, what we are seeing is that the mechanical energy is the major channel, rather than radiative, through which these objects emit most of the energy, or as a comparable amount of energy, sometimes compared to the radiative one. So for M87, to determine the kinetic energy is no easy task. Of course, if we assume it's a jet, what dominates that, most of this energy, this kinetic energy, mechanical energy, is channeled through the jet. And you need velocities, and it's not straightforward to have a tracer in the real plasma for that. So there are many intelligent ways has been applying the latitude to determine the kinetic power in these objects. In M87, there is a lot of work done. One of the works that is used a lot is from X-ray cavities, the holes that the jet produce in the X-ray halo. In M87, there is a huge X-ray halo when it passes through, for example, and from various works that has been used, the kinetic power in M87 is 10 to the 43, even 10 to the 44. That power comes from the core. But the reality is that we have one or two orders of magnitude less in accretion power. With accretion alone, we do not account for this. That is the thing. And the interesting part is what makes us to continue working on these objects. Let's go with Sombrero. sombrero, we can do exactly the same, but sombrero, since we have a hint of the creation of this, we can we see where from the same fitting we can estimate, instead of putting an upper limit, let's say, well, this is the accretion, this cooler, let's still determine an accretion power, so that's more realistic. We get of the order of 10^41. We can integrate the radiative luminosity from the source and the boosted as well, if the assumption is a jet, because most of the initial thing from the model is dominated by jet. So we get almost accretion power. We are almost there. But we know we have to account for the mechanical energy as well. And the mechanical energy of the source is almost one order of magnitude above the accretion power. So again, we have the problem. How we account from this energy with the accretion power that we can put at the best upper limits on these objects. So this story of the mechanical power, I wanted, yes, I hope I have minutes to do it, to illustrate to you that something that many people are working on it. We are very much conscious that mechanical power is a very fundamental channel for low activity black holes. In fact, as you go to high activity, this mechanical energy is much less. It's mostly radiative, so we have what we call the transient from the quasar mode, very active sources, mostly radiatively emitting energy, to the radio mode, which will be the cases as this one, low luminosity agents, low Eddington sources, where the major channel is mechanical. So there's a lot of work done on this topic, and of course the major thing is to be able to have an accurate determination of the mechanical power, the kinetic power. So Merloni, Andrea Merloni and Hens, they did this compilation of kinetic power for mostly low luminosity sources in where one could see these cavities, these holes produced by the jet as it moves towards the medium, and because of the PDV work that you can infer from the pressure, the shock, the passing of the jet through the medium, you can get an indirect measure of the mechanical power. Also from modeling the jet, people have been trying to determine this kinetic power from shocks, how the jet produces a shock in the medium from the front edge of the shock, how you can estimate the kinetic power. All these always are indirect measures. But anyway, putting all together, you got this nice correlation between the kinetic power from large number of objects of low luminosity agents, you see, and versus emission from the jet, from radio. This is emission and 5 GHz. So you see that it's a relatively nice correlation for all of them. This is emission directly from the jet, 5 GHz. And as you get with jets that are more radio loud, the kinetic power gets higher. So in both sense, they are getting higher kinetic power, more radio loud sources. As you get to more less emission in radio, so you are moving to, in a way, you are moving more to radio quiet sources, more type Cepheid galaxies if you want, because are radio quiet, and then your kinetic power is lower. So this is the idea that has been also explained in cosmological simulations of where we pass from the radio mode to the quasar mode. We have tried to do our best as well, trying to estimate the kinetic power. We are using a different tracer, which is the coronal gas, high ionization coronal gas. And here in this plot is a bit different of what is here. I plot the kinetic power in the y-axis for a number of low luminosity agents. All these are relatively low luminosity agents versus the volumetric luminosity in Eddington luminosities. So we have a wide range of Eddington luminosities from 10^-6, here will be MET7 and Sombrero, to very high Eddington luminosities in the range of 10% or so that will be here type cipher galaxies, okay, active galaxies. And the division line 10 to minus 3 will be around here or this region, okay? So when we can detect these high ionization lines with high angular resolution, we see that this coronal gas many times is spatially coincident with nodes in the jet, and then this is a good opportunity to have again an estimate of the kinetic power. And by doing that, we can get this type of plot where you see the, well, a bit the same as plot here. High kinetic power, which is in this axis, is for the most low luminosity Eddington sources. And while it's relatively low kinetic power for the very high Eddington luminosity sources. This is in the way I'm not going to claim this a kind of correlation. There is a lot of, to be fine tuning here. There's a lot of uncertainties, but the even we are trying, we are finding the same result all the time. As you go to low luminosity, the power is released in mechanical energy. Okay, so that is what I wanted to show you all. I just get to my questions. Power, which was the title of the talk, is a major enigma. How to estimate the power of the sources? Where do we get the power of the sources? And there is no problem with material surrounding the core of these galaxies. There is enough fuel to be accreted. The spectrum of these low luminosity is tend to be very featureless. No blue band, no infrared band. This is the quest, how we explain these spectral distributions, if in addition we think they are due to jet emission. Okay, and if we have a jet, we need to power the jet in a way. So jet is so far for us what it produced the simplest representation of the complete SED, and the hot accretion does not seem to account for it. The coal accretion, we can in some cases we see the hints for a coal accretion and for an accretion this day, so maybe still we can go with this scenario, classical accretion disk in this object, but simply gets cooler. Even if we have an accretion disk, which will be fine, will be the more relaxed way to understand these objects, the accretion power we get is not enough. And we have to go with alternatives to explain this power. And accretion is the best, you know, and we had to add something else. And one of the alternatives that people have been looking since long is also extracting power from the spin, from the black hole, from the spin. Most of these objects, in particular, the very massive black holes, I think they have a high, might have a high spin. We have problems. It's not easy to measure the spin of the black holes, but we require higher spins to get a lot of power from them. And it's not straightforward, also, this alternative, because it requires that the black hole is extremely efficient. And it's a little bit at odds to ask for those, for these low luminosity AENs to be extremely efficient when we for converting black hole spinning in power when their luminosity is very low. And okay, this is all what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Almudena, for this very nice talk. I need to implement some clapping here, maybe for the next seminar. And the talk is open for questions. Please, for all the people that is watching, just raise your hand and I will habilitate the micro. Don't be shy, please, and ask Almudena if you have any question. Okay, here is a question. Ivan, please. Okay, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Hello, Almudena. Thank you. Hello. Thank you very much. It was a nice talk. I have a question regarding, can you go back to the slide where you have the relation between the kinetic power and the luminosity? Yeah, so by assuming that, I mean, there are no very much uncertainties on that apparent correlation, what is the explanation or the guess that you have for that kind of behavior? So may it be that the material that goes into the jet for low luminosity AGNs enters into the jet by a different process than for high luminosity AGNs?
The material, I'm not sure. You mean so the relation for the coronal gas?
I'm talking about the jet formation process. Uh-huh. If you have a guess that that may be different for low luminosity and high luminosity AGNs, for example.
Mm-hmm. Well, the reality is that when we go to normal AGNs, so low high Eddington sources, these are very luminous relatively, but when we measure the kinetic energy is very low. Obviously, when you go to high, it's true that some high Eddington sources have also jets, but it seems that it's much less efficient. These jets in penetrating the galaxy, the medium, maybe is more, I don't know. We don't know why there must be more energy put in mechanical in one case than in the other. The reality is that we see that when we go to high active sources, the main channel is radiative. Maybe if we relate, for example, to the black hole spin, we could say that perhaps the most high Eddington luminous sources, the black hole, the spin, for example, is smaller or slower, and then we don't have this extra power, supposing that that would be the case, that we can add to the case of the low luminosity AGNs. But still, we have to see why the radiative luminosity in low luminosity AGNs is low. I think in the low luminosity AGNs, the case of this ADAF RIAF, it's a very elegant solution, maybe still we have it, in the sense that we accrete as in high luminous sources, but most of the energy is adverted. And so they are no relative efficient in a way. That is independent of the jet. It's simply that the material gets adverted. But why the black hole reacts and saying, okay, now I send all my power in mechanical form, I don't know. We don't know. There is a change. There is a exchange of channels, let's say, a preference of, or release of energy in both cases.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, the idea that I had in mind is that there is this very strong debate about the jet composition in AGN jet studies for radial out sources. Like, we still don't know because there are not good measurement about the composition of the plasma, and there is the two, let's say, ideas that are on the table are that the jet is composed by either electron positron or electron proton. So the kinetics of the jet itself and the power of the jet is significantly different for those two scenarios. And my question was if there may be a difference on that composition of the jet depending on the properties of the innermost regions of the AGN meaning black hole, magnetic field, and accretion. So, but yeah, all this is just guessing, you know.
The point is that we don't have very well determined how is the composition of the jet, but what is the difference between high Eddington sources and the jet there in low Eddington sources? It's true that as we go to low Eddington sources, the jet is more prominent than in high Eddington sources. This is also true. It could be the composition, the way material is launched to the jet, that the composition makes the mechanical energy much more efficient in one case than in the other. Yeah, but still you don't explain the case of why the relative luminosity is stronger in one case than in the other.
Sure, yeah.
Which is independent somewhat on the jet a priori.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ivan. Thank you, Almudena.
Thank you.
Any other question for Almudena? If not, we can finish this seminar. Thanks again, Almudena, for this talk. And next seminar next week is also about black holes. And it's following black holes evolution from equal 5, mergers and outflows. So everybody is invited here. Pepe Vilches is clapping, or he want to ask something? He's clapping.
Yes. I was clapping, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Almudena, for this talk.
Thank you. Thank you to you all for being there. Thank you.